I love you. worship song we're going to sing this morning is Hallelujah, amen. And we can all sing Hallelujah this morning, amen. Let's just fill the air with worship this morning. Hallelujah, glory to the name of Jesus. He is worthy to be praised, amen.
Glory to the name of Jesus.
We worship you, Lord God. We worship you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, glory to the name of Jesus.
Thank you.
touch your home.
Thank you, Jesus.
If you don't know, now you know how much God really loves you.
Amen. Yeah.
He's been too good to us.
Yes, yes.
Not to give him the praise, not to give him the worship. Hallelujah.
Yes, yes, yes.
God has blessed somebody this week. I don't know who you are. He blessed you this week. Hallelujah. And that's enough right there to give him praise. Hallelujah. We give your name the praise. We give your name the glory.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Lord,
I was reading the other day that there's an Islamic country, I can't pronounce the name, but it's known for Christian people who worship and who praise God. And as we speak today, ISIS is beheading women and children. But we stand right here and we can't stand to give him the praise and the glory and the honor that is due to him. We owe that to him this morning.
Help us, Lord.
We owe him the praise. We owe him the worship. We owe him. We have to give him the sacrifice.
Yes.
We do need him today. And that's why we sing hallelujah.
Amen.
Spirit of the Lord is truly in this place. All over the building, won't you lift your hands up to Him? Give God the glory. Give Him the praise. Because He's what? Of all our prayers. You ought to just thank God for what He's doing in your life and what He has yet to do in your life. We serve an awesome God, a mighty God, who's able to do more than we can ever do for ourselves. Thank you, praise team. Won't you give them a hand clap? I don't know about you, but I thank God for the little things. A lot of times we take things for granted. We think that we automatically should wake up in the morning. We think we should automatically have food on the table, clothes on our back. But we ought to thank God for everything, even the little things. We're now up to our mission and education office. We're in the hands of the ushers. If you have a prayer request, put it in the basket and we will pray for you. Thank you. prayer time, so far. I don't know about you, but I need prayer every minute, every hour of the day. So the Bible tells us that man should always pray. If you need prayer this morning, won't you stand where you are and come to the altar? Prayer is an answer to all of our problems. I dare you to pray and just stand back and watch God work.
Appoints. More man chooses, but you appoint.
So Lord, it don't matter who's in the White House. We know that you are a God who's still in control. Bless our country, Lord. It seems that evil is on the rise. But in spite of all the evilness and the wickedness in this world, God, we know that your hand is still upon us. Bless right now, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, help us to love one another and to care for one another as you have loved us. Bring us all together, oh God, on one accord, in unity, headed in the same direction. We love you today, oh God. We magnify you today. We lift you up. We glorify you in the name of Jesus. Now, Lord, we ask your blessings upon the man who's going to preach your word. Give him a word from on high, Lord, a word that will cause someone to come right. Someone to come to know you better. And Lord, let us not forget. Forgive us, oh God, of our sins. Lord, we know there are some things that we've done that we shouldn't have done. We know that there are some things we said that we shouldn't have said. There are some places we have gone that we shouldn't have gone. Lord, we just ask your forgiveness right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you right now for hearing this prayer. We thank you for answering this prayer. It's in Jesus' name we asked it all. Let the church say amen. Amen. Amen.
Jesus, the fabulous voices of Saint Martha. This is time in our service, and we'd like to acknowledge any visitors. If you are visiting with us, would you please stand and share with us your name or where you're from?
Amen.
Coming together to declare the glory of the Lord and to celebrate Jesus as King. We are a praying church with a praying pastor. May God richly bless and keep you. We hope to see you soon. I'd like to share the following announcements. The men's ministry will meet on Monday, November 7th at 7 p.m. The women's ministry will also meet on Monday, November 7th at 7 p.m. The men's ministry and the prayer breakfast will be on Saturday, November 12th at 9 a.m. The theme is Men Cultivating Growth, and the scripture is 1 Thessalonians 4 and 10. Voices at St. Mark annual musical will be on Sunday, November 30th at 3:30 p.m. The theme is Nothing But the Blood, and the scripture is 1 John 1 and 7.
We're excited.
Oh, I'm sorry. November 20th. The musical is on November 20th. If I said 30th, it was an error. Youth and Children's Church will be on Sunday, November 27th. The Deaconess Board will host a holiday event on Saturday, December 17th from 6 to 10 p.m. The event will be held at the Dallas County Schools Technology and Training Center, 5151 Samuel Boulevard, Dallas, Texas, 75228. The attire is semi-formal or formal. The donation is $35 per person or $65 per couple. If you are interested, please see Sister Sharon Hudson. Or if you'd like to make a payment arrangement, please see Sister Janice Henry. You have a card. Thanks so much. The praise is simple and the words are few, but behind them is a whole lot of appreciation. St. Mark family, thank all of you for your cards, prayers during this time of bereavement. Your kind words really meant a lot to me and my family. It is such a blessing to have a church family like we have at St. Mark. Thank you so much again for everything, the Crowder family, Walter and Bonnie. For those who are planning to on going to New York May 17th next year, we need your completed forms and deposits for airline and hotels as soon as possible. For any questions or concerns, please see Sister Linda Turner or Sister Paulette Jones. Let's keep Sister Mary Harper in our prayers. She suffered a fall and is currently in rehab. When we get more information, we will make it available to all of you. The deaconess will have a call meeting after worship service today in the Educational Center. There will be containers in the Educational Center and the River Sanctuary for donations for non-perishable food items for Thanksgiving baskets. I would like to meet with all of those that are going to the George Bush Library immediately after worship service. The Matrons Ministry will be offering food items after worship service. After the Food for Thought, the youth ministry will have an announcement. Food for Thought, try Jesus. If you don't like it, the devil will always take you back.
My name is Sister Pamela Berry, and the youth ministry, we had an opportunity to go to a training and it's called the Orange Train. I just want to talk to you, and it was myself, Sister Bingham, Reverend Lawson, and Sister Anthony. We all went to this training. I want to say thank you to our pastor and his absence, because when originally he wanted us to go to the National Baptist, but I couldn't go at that particular time. So just so happened that on the internet, we used this curriculum called the Orange Curriculum, and they had a training. So why not go to a training in the curriculum that we're using? But it turned out to be a blessing. And I just wanted to share with you some things that we learned, and we're all going to come up and say a few things about the classes that we attended. There were 3 homework class sessions and 2 breakout sessions. But I'm just going to read what we have here. We went to as a group so we could get the entire team on the same page, and that's important. And it says right here, we had a chance to experience fresh insights and new ideas together. It creates a learning interaction that can be powerful and last from week to week. So that was one of our purposes. So the conference was about, will what happens in your church this Sunday matter in someone's life on Monday? And we had an opportunity to show video, and you know, used to be Sunday, the church had a monopoly on it. That's not the case anymore. Our ministry starts on Monday morning. So the thing was, it was Monday is coming. So what do you have planned? So some of the things that they talked about was design a strategic experience each Sunday, reach families who don't show up this Sunday, how to reach them, craft a message that lasts far beyond Sunday, and help a small group leaders stay connected with kids after Sunday. Okay, now one of the whole group, our first whole group was the Sunday mindset. So I said, make a decision based on who is coming. That's the Sunday mindset, because we already know that we're going to be here. But the Monday mindset is you make changes to reach who isn't coming. Okay, your Sunday mindset was you recruit enough volunteers for every room, but the Monday mindset was you recruit a consistent leader for every kid. Your Sunday mindset is you spend your week building excellent weekend programs, whereas your Monday mindset, you spend your week investing in parents and volunteers. Okay, and I attended 2 breakouts, and we all attended separate breakouts. My first one was called Understanding Monday in the City Ministry, and of course, you know, St. Mark is in an urban area. My first presenter was from Boston, and her name was Virginia Ward, and she spoke about keeping the pulse on the multicultures in the city, and she talked about what diversity looks like. And what it looks like on a Monday morning. The diversity in the city and families are really complex. And as a teacher, I can tell you about the complex families that we see. Children may have 2 moms in the home or 2 dads. We have, I call them sister wives, and then we have single family home. But this is our culture that in our diversity that's in our community. These are the people who are we ministering to on Monday morning. And so she suggested by having an access map. If they church, they have an asset map, you know, for their community. So they can reach those people in the community. And then she talked about resources that are available in your community also. It says, on Monday morning, there are many distractions for these families, like youth and family away from, that distracts youth and family away from their purposes. There's dysfunctions in like inequalities in the system, because everybody's not on the same playing field. So we have to think about the inequalities. You know, we can be equal, but it may not be inequalities, I'm trying to say, in the system. And then difficulty generally from the lack of something. So that's what some of the things that families are dealing with on Monday morning. There are also opportunities, and I'm glad you covered it, because we can talk about the difficulties, but what are the opportunities? Cover your community with prayer. Cast a vision for your community, what your community can be and what your community can do. Connect with resources. Create spaces to help youth experience good, God, and others. And you have to work together every week, and that's where planning, intentional planning comes into place. And then my second breakout session was called Discovering the Secret of Recruiting Volunteer is Retention. Because she said you don't want different people coming in front of your children all the time, but retaining volunteers. The message was stop recruiting and start retaining. And we talked about the worst experiences as a volunteer. You know, people said that it's not organized. And that's why people don't volunteer. Not a clear expectation, no resources, the lack of involvement of ministered leaders, high criticism, and low appreciation. But then they asked us what was our best experience of volunteering, like empowerment to lead, organization, clear goals, making a difference, clear direction, clear vision, and feeling of appreciation. So the four things volunteer needs is significance, to feel significant support, connection, and empowerment. So in closing on my part, I just remember some quotes that we had that were meaningful to me. Doesn't matter. Kids matter more than adults. What the church does for kids, your church will never die. What you do for kids keeps Sunday interesting. Kids, I mean, giving teens opportunity to serve, strategy matters, intentional matters. Your church matters. You have a place to belong. You have a place to belong. Family matters. Next step for me is recruiting, because I don't want to just go to a training and not be effective. So mine was recruiting and intentional planning. I'm asking the church for prayer as we go forth in this youth ministry.
I hate to tell you, she said exactly what I had. Also, I want to ask a question. What happens in your church this Sunday matters in someone's life on Monday. Orange Tour help us to design and to help to have an experience each Sunday. Also to help reach families, help leaders to stay connected to our kids after Sunday. The Orange Tour encourage us to ask the youth, what matters? Help our kids to be ministry minded. Use our technology like Facebook, Twitter, and etc. You know what I'm talking about. To be available, to be creative, do activities. And the outbreak session I took was Doug Field, and his topic was mobilizing students to serve weekly. And all he's saying was to help empower students to have a positive impact in the lives of their peers and in their families. We need to change our language. Words do matter. Lives matter. Family matter. God matters. Help us to inspire and motivate our young people. We need to change from, we always hear children, church of tomorrow, but we understand now the children are the church of what? Right now. Change from Sunday to Sunday, from today and then the next Sunday come. We need to change those things. How to serve from Sunday through Sunday. What a kid does affect what they believe. Teach how to serve God. I just wrote some stuff down. On a spiritual level as well as a secular level. Let me help you just for a little while. A couple of our sessions here on Wednesday, we've been talking to our young people about you need to be able to balance your spiritual life and your secular life. Because sometimes if you weigh on one side too much, you lose on the other side. And we must have a balance in our lives for our young people. Listen, the Bible says we are in this world, but don't be a part of the world. Help the young people to get involved in God's ministry. Ask our young people, what is your gift? What are you good at? And then he says, warning, this takes some time for someone. It takes time. What if we change from always thinking eternal? He said that we need to change from just thinking about eternal life, but think about the kingdom of God. And then he went to Mark 10 and 29. Let me read this real quick. I want to see. First one, start with 28. Then Peter began to say unto him, lo, we have left all and have followed thee. And Jesus answered and said, verily I say unto you, there is no man that had left house or brethren or sister or father or mother or wife or children or land for my sake and the gospel. In other words, Jesus is saying, when we're on the mission field for him, don't worry about what you're going to eat. Don't worry about what you're going to wear. He said, I got you covered. I just need you to do the work that I've told you to do. And I'm going to show you right quick. I saw this young man right there. He was trying to show me some scripture. And he had a scripture, and mama just said, no, not right now, baby. That put you on the spot, mama. But the Bible tells us that we should not shun our children, but give them the opportunity to work their gift. And that's what we're planning to do in 2017, is to let our young people work their gift. We asked him Wednesday night in the class, what are some things we could do? And we kind of picked their minds to see what they like, which way direction they are going. I don't want to be boring. What is fun? And I understand what fun to me is going to see the sick and the shut in. Fun to me is to help somebody that's in need. Fun to me is doing the work of God. And then I don't mind going to Turner Falls. I don't mind going to somewhere that has some fun me. But to me, fun is doing God's work first. That's fun. To know that God can use our young people. Look at our movement. I'm finna say I ain't gonna start preaching. But look at the movement in the 60s. That were young people doing some work. And let me tell you on the secular side. Back in the day when I was really out there, there was young people that were slaying dope. And not the old ones. Because the young ones can go to juvenile, but I'll go to penitentiary. So we're going to teach our young people and parents, we're going to ask you to help support us. I know you have school, you have games, but I just read, if you let secular life be more important than God, I'm sure.
Well, we just want to say thank you for supporting us, supporting the youth ministry, and even more so supporting the Christian Education Department. Just pray for us and pray with us as we try to serve you. We all serve you. Amen. So my session, we all attended some general sessions in the morning and after lunch and then towards the end. But we had breakout sessions, and the session that I went to, because one of, like Sister Barry says, she's trying to focus her her energy towards recruitment of parents and volunteers and mentors. Well, my focus is trying to get the next gen, the next generation. So that's the people from what age groups? What do you think? Yeah, 18, 20 something, 18, 30, yeah. That's gonna be my focus. And they're called the next gen. And so the session that I went to was called Leading the Church to Make Next Gen Matter, and the presenter was Carrie Norwolf. He's from Canada. He didn't sound good. But anyway, I could understand him clearly, no accent or anything. He broke it down into three main parts. It was a very interesting session, and I learned so much. You know the feeling that you feel after you come from a conference, you're all fired up and ready? I just wish we could feel that way all day, every day, because once we left, we were just brainstorming and, you know, getting all these ideas together, and then I just hope that momentum doesn't die. And y'all just pray for us on that, because we got a good group to work with. I'm just so blessed to be working with the people that you see before us. So three main points. The first main point is understand, and remember we're talking about the next gen. Understand that things have changed a lot. And the quote that he says is, he used was, culture never asks permission to change. It just changes. Okay? So when the pace of change outside of an organization becomes faster than the pace of change inside of the organization, that's a problem. So it means we've got to change with that next gen, with that youth. We've got to change with them. We cannot remain stagnant. Some statistics, it says 50% of next gen church members who have had children, we're talking about 1830, okay. 50% of next gen church members who have had children have stated that having children did not affect their connection to the church. Having children did not affect their connection to the church. Therefore, we cannot use the excuse that these folks are staying at home because they're dealing with raising their children. We no longer can use that as an excuse. Okay, because 50% said that's not the reason why I'm staying at home. Okay, the next statistic, 5% of next-gen church members stated that having children helped them become more active in the church. That's a blessing for us. However, that means 95% of next-gen church members do not feel like just because they had children, they're convinced to be active in the church. So that means we must find other ways to get them to show up to church. We got to find other ways. The next gen families are not like us traditionalists. I'm a traditionalist. Some of us, you know, let's be real. We come to church, not now, but there was a time when we came to church because we felt guilty. Like if we stayed at home, we felt guilty. You know, y'all understand what I'm saying. We were tortured by our parents and our grandparents, and we attempted to stay at home. I know I was, I don't know about anybody else. So this is not the case for the next gen. They don't think that way. There's a disappearance of guilt, okay? So we gotta find other ways to get them to show up. Even when families do attend church, they attend less often, okay? In a next-gen church member's mind, they honestly don't see themselves as disconnected from the church, okay? They cannot see us for 8 weeks and then show up to church as if it were yesterday. That's the way their mindset is. Just because you don't see them does not mean that they have left the church. So that's good news. Just because we don't see this next gen does not mean they have left the church. They are still there. They still, when they go to the grocery stores, they're talking to their neighbors and they say, you know, at my church at St. Mark. So keep that in mind. That's good news. Therefore, we got to find ways, other ways. Most people nowadays see the church in the same fashion as going to the gym. And that's the only way I can relate it because I go to the gym. Their goal determines their commitment, okay? So what they hope to get out of coming to church determines their commitment to the church. So if they don't hope to get anything out of the church, their commitment to the church is not that good, okay? So just like, you know, I don't need to go to the gym to become fit. I can stay at home, work out, or whatever. That don't have to happen, but I mean, I could. Okay? So that direct correlation, they see, what am I going to get out of church, which directly relates to my commitment to the church. So we got to find other ways to show them what their goals should be related to the church, okay? The next gen family struggles with every possible social issue you can imagine. Therefore, they are less likely to show up to church for fear that church people will not receive them, okay? And I know this from a fact. from talking to people like Brother Lorente, Sister Katrina, Sister Chardé, Sister Maggie, Carolyn Maggie, not Maggie Maggie, but talking to Sister Quaff, they got so many things going on in their lives that we cannot even begin to imagine. But they fear that if they come to church members, they're not going to be received well. We've got to do better, folks. We have got to do better. The reality is that a lot of church members are going through those same struggles. They're just afraid to open up to someone for fear they're going to be rejected or talked about or shunned. So we've got to do better about that. The next gen parents, kids matter to them. Matter to them maybe more so than they need to. Okay? The way Carrie described it is that they put their children up on such a high pedestal. Such a high pedestal. And that's kind of like worshiping them. Okay? So, humans are designed to worship. They are just not designed to be worshiped. Okay? So, the result of this type of child-centered parenting results in the fact, and this is just the honest truth, that we are raising an entire generation of kids that have a high arrogance because we're holding them up to this pedestal, but crushingly low self-esteem. Because we give them everything, we shower them with gifts, everybody wins, there's no losers kind of mentality. So they don't know how to fail. They've never failed. So when things happen, it is crushing to them. So their self-esteem is low. So as the church, we've got to adjust that and find some balance there. So we've got to approach them in a different way, and we've got to approach their parents in a different way. That's the first point. Second point, we need to embrace lessons, youth lessons, Sunday school lessons, Bible study lessons. We need to embrace them as strategies and not just curriculum. It's not just words. Strategies. We must begin with the end in mind, and us educators know that's backwards design. You got to begin with the end in mind. If you know the end, you're more likely to get to it because you set those goals to get to it. So we have to stop siloing ministries. Carrie says it shouldn't be teen, separate from youth, separate from children, separate. Those are siloing or standing alone. It has to be from the cradle to college. From the cradle to college. So, and then even afterwards, after they go to college, we have to reach out to them so that they can come back and serve us. Okay? We send them out to come back and serve us. We want that to stick in their mind when they go away. I need to come back to serve my church. Okay? Authentic community beats better programming, and we appreciate it hearing that. Because you have all these big churches with all these programs. We got the youth ministry. We got the, you remember the cassette ministry? Y'all remember that? Am I that old? I know I am, but that's okay. You have all these, you have the photography committee. You got this ministry and that ministry. And they got all these programs. No. Authenticity, you know, being authentic is much better. So authentic community is better than multiple programs. Every time. We don't have to have a million programs for families to be a part in the church. We simply must make sure that the ministries that we do have are authentic and they encourage personal interaction. Okay? People are being entertained to death. Think about our kids. Our babies, when I go out to eat with my nephew and my niece, they don't even talk to me. They give me a hug and kiss, they sit on the table and they pull out all these things that they hook up to, and first thing they ask the waitress or the waiter, do you have Wi-Fi? Yeah, you know, it's like, what? So how was your day? I'm sorry, what'd you say? Yeah, it's like they're being entertained to death, okay? So what they are really looking for, what the next gen family is really looking for is meaning. Don't entertain them. They need meaning. They need community. They need to belong. Okay? Meaningful interaction will stand out. It's about how we love each other. So think about how you're loving the members of this church. Think about how you're loving each other. Kids want to come back when they have a relationship with people in church. We should have be activating our Mondays to breathe new life into our Sundays. So start with the Monday in mind, not with the Sunday in mind. Okay? And we should be partnering up with next-gen families. Therefore, that'll bring their kids. Okay? It's kind of opposite. I thought if you attach the kids, the parents will come. No. You attach and find meaning for the parents, the kids will come. Okay? The third thing, and I know a lot of people don't like to hear this, this is the third point that Carrie made, you need to fund what you fuel. You need to fund what you fuel, okay? Your budget and your staff, your staffing reveals your what you truly value, okay? Where your treasure is, there is your heart. Yes? Okay. So, you attract highly capacity leaders by giving them a high level of challenging things to do. Don't set the bar low and then get upset when the next gen family don't show up. Okay? They don't want to show up to something that's not doing anything. Most people are like that. They get on the bandwagon after it's in movement, after it's in motion. They'll think about doing something for you, okay? So we can't set the bar low. We need to set the bar high in hopes that we will attract those leaders, those building capacity leaders. And then we must show the expectation that we want by modeling the behavior, such as being on time for events. Ouch. Okay, being prepared when we get to those events and being committed. So the next gen family will come if we model what we expect of them. The final note, we must be able to live in the tension. We start this by listening. Living in the tension means when a next gen family member or any church member comes to you with a serious issue, like homosexuality or whatever, you can't shun them. That's why we're here. Okay? We must look at situations as problems to be solved versus tensions to be managed. Not managing it. Problems to be solved. This will help us better reach our next gen members. And the last quote that I loved says, how you are loved will impact how you live. But how you live will never impact the way you live. Okay?
God is good. He is good. Let's give it up for the team that works with us. Samar, thank you for supporting them and for allowing them to go. We see that they really took advantage of the material that was shared. A lot of useful information. You know, when I was sitting there listening to them, I was thinking about how the universal church is eternal, but the local church is not. What I mean by that is that there is no guarantee that the local church that you may reside in or that somebody else may reside in is going to be here next year. All right. But what keeps us here, what keeps the door open is being reverent. Now, the church is reverent. The church has someone who is reverent, and that's God. But the challenge for us is showing the reverence of God. As we see in our churches today, the predominant age group that is really missing in action are the age groups that they are representing. So we're thankful to God that they have taken the challenge and they're doing the things necessary to try to reach that demographic. We're asking you, St. Mark, as they come to you for support, as they come to you for participation, don't say no to them, but help them, if you will. So I want to thank our youth pastor, Reverend Loftus. I want to thank our director of Christian education, Cassandra. And I want to thank my wife, who is the director of our youth ministry. Amen. Sound like they have their minds made up. We are glad to see you this morning, St. Mark, and trust that you've had a great time thus far in the service. Announcements have been made. Let's just try to govern ourselves accordingly. As we see, Pastor Madison is not here. He called me, said he wasn't feeling well, so that's why he's not here. So let's keep him in prayer. To our guests, thank you for being here with us today. We're glad to have you come back today. All right, we're going to have the choir come and give us a brief selection. Come and give us one verse, quick chorus, and then I come back before you. Amen?
Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." The title to the message this morning is Help Wanted. Help Wanted. Ursus, you've been faithful today. We want to thank you for being at your post. The duty you made. When Jesus walked this earth some more than 2,000 years ago, he did his same mark in an earthly, physical body. A body just like yours and mine. He laid his omnipresence aside to the point where he was only able to be at one place at a time. That's why in verse 35, we see that he went to where the people were. Ministered to them. Instead of waiting for the people to come to him. And really saying, well, we see here a ministry model for the church to follow. There are three things here that I want to just grab from the text and then take my seat. Notice, if you will, in verse 36, we see the compassion of the Savior. Because verse 36 starts out by saying, when he saw, when Jesus saw. When Jesus saw the crowds of people, he didn't just see people. But what he saw were hearts and souls. In other words, St. Mark, what I'm suggesting is that Jesus, when he saw the people, when he saw the crowd, he looked past their faults. And he saw their needs. What we notice about people, St. Mark, speaks to what's really important to us. Let me say it again. What we notice about a person speaks to what really is important to us. Let me give you an example. If I was to walk by a barber, he's not necessarily going to be looking at the clothes that I'm wearing. And the reason for that, Brother Blue, is because that's not the industry that he's in.
Yeah.
From which he gets his income. So, Sarah, when I walk by a barber, one of the first things he's gonna look at is my hair. Because he sees me as a potential customer. Same mark if Christians can only realize we too are in business. We too are in business. We are in the soul winning business. To the point where when we see people, we should see people who have souls that need to be saved. Do I have any witnesses here today? And when you notice Jesus, the text helps us to see that when he saw the people, when he saw the crowd, he had compassion. He was moved to compassion. And it was to the point where he did something about it. Oftentimes when you look in the Gospels and you see Jesus, you see that when he encountered people, he had compassion on them. Like it was with the man who had leprosy. When he saw the man with leprosy, Jesus' compassion moved him to the point where he felt the same loneliness that that leper had. Because you do know in that day, if you had leprosy, you were ostracized. You were kicked outside of the community. You were not accepted among everybody. You had to go live outside of town. Jesus' compassion caused him to feel the same loneliness that that leper had. When the father, whose daughter had just died, came running to Jesus, because of compassion, Jesus felt the same bereavement that that father was feeling. The question I think we should ask ourselves today, when we see people, do we feel what they're feeling? We just had a team of people to come and speak to us about how the culture is changing. Ain't asking for our permission, changing anyway. But if the culture outside of the organization is changing quicker than the organization, then we see why we lose our reverence. People are suffering. People are going through it. The question is, as a child of God, when we see people, are we feeling what they are feeling? Because the truth of the matter is, the reason why we may not be going through it because of God's grace. But keep on living. Keep on living. See, if we were moved like compassion, like Jesus was, we'll feel what they are feeling. And like Jesus, not only will we feel it, we'll do something about it. Are you moved with compassion when you see other people? Or are you moved to criticism when you see other people? I don't know about you, but I thank God that when the Lord looked upon me, he didn't look upon me with criticism. But he looked past my faults. And he saw my need. And not only did he see it, but he did something about it. Are y'all going to go with me this morning? I'm one third of the way finished with this sermon. Are y'all going to go with me this morning? Notice here, we see the compassion of the Savior in verse 36. But in verse 36, we also see the condition of the sinners. Notice, when Jesus saw the crowd, he described them. He said they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Am I in the Bible? Y'all looking at me like I'm not in the Bible. Is it right? Is it not there? Come on, go with me now. He described them as being harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Really what Jesus was pointing to, he was pointing to how during that day the false religious leaders was victimizing the people. They were really not, the religious leaders for the most part really was not doing their job. They were misusing the people. They were taking advantage of the people. They were bullying the people. They were really putting a yoke around the people's neck. They were not representing their position like they were, to the point where they left the people in a helpless condition. In the Bible, sometimes you'll see how the Bible compares people with sheep. We see it right here in our text. And the reason for that is because apparently people and sheep have some things in common. When you look at Isaiah, for example, Isaiah 53, Isaiah said, all we like sheep have gone astray. When you look at the psalmist in Psalms 100, he says, we are God's people and the sheep of his pasture. Even David said in Psalms 23, the Lord is my shepherd, which implied that if the Lord is my shepherd, then I must be one of his sheep. The reason why, St. Mark, sheep needs a shepherd It's because by nature, sheep are not swift. They're slow. Predators can run a sheep down real easy. I mean, heck, depends on what day of the week is, bear can run one of them down. You know, if I had my oatmeal that morning with the raisins on top, sprinkle with a little cinnamon, I might be able. The reason why sheep needs a shepherd is because by nature sheep are slow.
That's right.
Predators can run a sheep down real easy.
Right.
Not only are sheep not swift, but sheep are not smart.
Y'all
don't get this anymore. Somebody tell me what's the opposite of smart? Y'all said that. Y'all said that. Sheep need a shepherd because they are not swift of feet. They're slow. They need a shepherd because they're not the smartest creature. Predators can easily ambush them. Sheep are defenseless. Notice, they don't have any defensive weapons. They don't have any offensive weapons. Sheep don't have claws that they can scratch with. They don't have fangs, they don't have teeth that they can bite with. Sheep are defenseless. And sheep do not have a good sense of direction. If a sheep is left unto itself, it will just wander and wander and wander days upon end, until it just drops dead and die. What is the point I'm trying to make this morning? The point I'm trying to make this morning is we need Jesus. Do I have any witnesses in the house today? We need Jesus. Because without Jesus, we too are like sheep without a shepherd. We are alone, we are without protection, and we are vulnerable to the attacks of the enemy. The reason why so many people are struggling today is because they don't have a shepherd in their lives. And the devil is taking full advantage of them because they're alone. They don't have any protection. They are vulnerable to his attacks. And if is anybody here today, and if you don't know Jesus, you are a prime candidate for the enemy's attack. You need a shepherd. Because by nature, you're not the swiftest thing around. Do I need to just go ahead and call the roll by nature? I ain't gonna call nobody dumb. We need a shepherd. So there's some things I've learned. There's some things that my money can't do for me. There are some things that my money can't do for me. There are some things that my education can't do for me. Now, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with money. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with education. But they have their limits. I need a shepherd. I need Jesus. Because by nature, there are some limitations that I have that makes me vulnerable to the enemy. Jesus said they were harassed to the point of being helpless because they were like sheep. Without. That's the condition right now of the sinner. But notice, as I hasten to a close, not only do we see the compassion of the Savior, the condition of the sinners. But in verses 37 and 38,
yes,
we see the commission,
right,
of the saints.
Yeah.
Notice how Jesus shifted his focus.
Yeah.
Notice how when we get to verse 37 and 38, how his focus moves from the flock to the field.
Yeah.
You see that?
Yeah.
At first he was focusing on the flock. Now he's focusing on the field.
Okay.
The concept of the flock pictures the fact that we need God.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Because sheep needs a...
Yeah, right.
But the concept of the field pictures the fact that God needs us. I wish I had y'all.
I'm with you, baby.
When you look here at the text, the problem that is being pointed out in the text, who Jesus is the one that's pointing out, the problem that's being pointed out in the text is not because of lack of a harvest. That's not the problem that Jesus is pointing out in this text. It's not because there's a lack of a harvest. It's not because there's a lack of opportunities. Because he said the harvest is plentiful.
Yeah. Come on now.
The problem that he points out in the text is not God.
Yeah, right. Come on.
Because God is still saved.
Yeah, right. That's right.
But the problem that he's pointing out in the text is right there in verse 37. He says the workers.
Yeah.
Y'all with me?
Yeah.
The workers are few. Can I suggest this morning that the reason why the workers were few then, and you fast forward 2,000 years later, the reason why the workers are few today is because when it comes time to reap in the harvest, it requires work. The problem we have in most of our churches today is that we don't have enough people that want to go to. We don't have enough Christians that want to work.
Yeah.
Now, can I just share something with you this morning? And this is Reverend Barry talking. All right? This is not Jesus. This is Reverend Barry talking right here. Okay? I want to make it clear. This is Reverend Barry talking about Reverend Barry. I want y'all to hear that as well. For illustrative purposes. I don't feel bad if every time when time comes to eat, this is illustrated purposes only. It can be applied to any other situation. But I don't feel bad if every time when time comes for me to eat, that the only thing that I bring to the table is an appetite. I would feel bad if that was always the case. Never do I bring any meat to the table. Never do I bring any taters to the table. I don't even bring a liter of soft drink to the table. Never do I bring nothing. All the thing I bring to the table is an appetite. Now, I'm not too proud to receive. I'm not too proud to be a recipient of somebody else's hard work, but I would like to think that there will come a time in Barry's life that Barry one day will begin to reciprocate the hard work that somebody has demonstrated towards him. Are y'all with me? One of the challenges that's facing the local churches across the board today, and I'm not just talking about denominations, not limited to denomination, regardless of denomination, regardless of the size of the church, whether it's a small church, medium-sized church, or mega church, regardless to the ethnicity of the church, whether it's a black church, white church, Hispanic church, Indian church, Asian church, one of the challenges And problems that's facing our local churches across the board today is we have too many Christians who just want to be on the receiving and never, never, ever want to reciprocate what they have received. We cool with receiving. We cool with the benefits of everybody else's sweat equity. But we never want to reciprocate what somebody else has done. Now, if you are one of the ones who do reciprocate, if you are one of the ones who do give your time, who does give your talent, who does share with the church your treasure, if you're one of those ones that are here today, you should be commended. Because you represent the minority of those who are in the church, because the majority of us just receive. But if you have become to where you reciprocate your time, your talent, your treasure, you ought to be commended today for your level of maturity. Because you understand that not only should we receive, but we should also give. You are to be commended today. As a matter of fact, you represent just 20% of the 100%. Because 80% is not doing it. The problem Jesus points out in the text today is not with the harvest. It's plentiful. Plenty of opportunity. And it's not with God, because God is still doing his part. He says, but the workers are few. Let me keep my promise. I said I'm not going to be before you long. He then says to the disciples, pray to the Lord of the harvest that he may send out workers into his harvest field. Jesus told them to pray. And the same is true for us today. But let me let you in on something. When you pray, be prepared for God to say that you are the answer to your prayer. I say that because in chapter 10, the ones that the Lord told to pray in chapter 9 was the one that ended up having to go out in the field in chapter 10. Can Reverend Gary share something else with you? Now this is Barry again. This ain't Jesus. This is Barry talking about Barry. I'm talking about nobody else. I'm talking about me. Are y'all with me? Got it clear? Here's another philosophy of life that I have adopted for Barry. I don't believe in asking anybody to do anything that I myself am not willing to do. You can rest assured, if I come and ask you to do something, it's because Barry is prepared to get right in there with you. You can rest assured, if I ask you for anything, you can rest assured, I ain't asking you to do it and I'm not willing to do it myself. That's a philosophy of mine. What am I trying to say? We got a lot of people, too many people are asking other folks to do things and they themselves not willing to be part of the solution. God bless my marriage. God bless my relationship. God bless my finances. God bless my employment. Bless my income. Bless my career. When we ourselves are not willing to be part of the solution for what we're asking. I am not going to ask God to do something for me, and I'm not willing to get in and do my part. Am I making any sense this morning? I can't pray a prayer, and I'm not willing to be part of the solution. So if I'm going to pray and ask God to send some folks up into the harvest, I need to be prepared to put my overalls on too. I'm not going to ask somebody to do something. And I'm not willing to do it myself. Can I go ahead and close the sermon? Story is told about an old farmer who was on his deathbed. to the point where he called his two sons to his bedside. He says, my sons, he say, I give you my farm and I give you my fields. And I give them to you in equal shares. He says, I even have some ready money for you, some seed money for you. He says, but the bulk of my wealth is out there buried in the field, about 18 inches below the surface. And before St. Marquis took his last breath, he expressed to them his regret that he didn't know exactly, Deacon Reeves, where the treasure was. Somebody already know where I'm going. The story said the old farmer died, the son buried him, and soon, Ronnie Jr., as they buried him, those boys went out to the field. Dug up every inch of the ground, looking for that hidden treasure, but to no avail. So they said to each other, well, we done dug up the field, we might as well sow some seeds. They sowed some seeds, and Brother Blue, they ended up reaping a little harvest. When the season changed and opportunity presented itself again, Brother Barnett, they went right back out there. Dug up every inch of the field, looking for that hidden treasure. But Sister Williams and Noah there, they said to each other, well, we done dug up this field, we might as well sow some seed. They did, and they reaped a bigger harvest. St. Mark, this went on year after year. They went out there digging up everything, looking for that hidden treasure, to no avail, only to end up sowing seed, reaping their harvest. It wasn't until years later that they was much older, much wiser, that they realized, the light came on, that they realized what their father meant years ago. What did they realize? That real treasure only comes as a result of hard work. St. Mark, what have I been trying to say this morning? God has a harvest. God has a harvest. It's plentiful. He has a harvest for St. Mark. Yes, he does. That's why we're planted here. He has a harvest. It's plentiful. You know what? Not only does he have a harvest for this church, he has a harvest for every Christian. That is with your name on it. Uniquely for you. But in order for us to realize the harvest, it's going to require that we go to the Lord. The kingdom of God still has a help wanted sign posted. The kingdom of God still has a help wanted sign posted. The question is, are there any applicants? Is there anybody that wants to? The doors of the church are still open. Have been for more than 2,000 years. For somebody to enter into the Lord's harvest. If you are that person today, you understand that the condition that you're in is one of a sheep who's without a shepherd. And you know that you have been vulnerable to the attacks of the enemy. And God has spoken to you this morning and told you, you need Jesus. You need a shepherd. If you are that person, this time is for you. We have deacons who are standing, who are willing to assist you in this time of transition. Give this family a hand. Amen. It's good. Somebody ought to be rejoicing right now. Look at this lovely thing. Look at this lovely thing. A father, a mother, two fine young sons. Is there anybody else this morning? You want to come up under the protection of the Lord. While our musicians play and our choir sing, we invite you to come.
Amen.
Anthony. God bless you, man. All right, we are definitely glad to have the Baker family and their two sons, Joy and Jalen, with us, who first time is. And they want to become part of the same morning. God just keep on giving. It keeps on giving. We want to pray also for Brianna and their concerns. And then after we finish, we're going to ask if Brother McDonald, Reverend Range, Sister Griffith, and my wife, if y'all would take them to the back. And let's make the most out of this. Our Father, Heaven, Lord, indeed, you are worthy of all the praise for the good things that you have done. And Lord, we thank you for all those who have come on the cover of the prayer requests that have been made right now. Lord, you know exactly the concerns that they have. Pray right now that you would just minister and help them to navigate whatever it is that they're going through to get to where you want them to be. And for the Baker family, thank you for this loving family today. Thank you for sending them our way. And thank you, Father, for navigating the circumstances to where they have made a commitment to you. Now we pray for them. We pray, Lord, that as they assimilate into this congregation, that you will cause them to be able to realize what it is that you have in store for them. And for any concerns that they may have, we want to lift them up to you right now. And Father, as we take them to the back and as we further minister to them, allow us to say the words that you would have us to say. Saute our words with grace, so that they may minister as the way you would have to. Now, Lord, we thank you for hearing this prayer. We thank you for answering it. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Saint Mark, won't you give this family a hand? Give them both your hand. If y'all would take them to the back. If y'all would take them to the back. Let's minister to them as God would have us to. Receive from you the offerings that you prepared to give today. Our ushers are going to come and they're going to give us direction. And then we'll go right into the communion service. Thank you.
Thank you. Sing a hymn, the hour after the night of the body. Amen.
give our people a hand. They do an awesome job every third Sunday. And I want to commend our deacons from last Sunday. You know, the pastor was preaching over at the joint assembly of all of the Galilee Grace churches. And St. Mark deacons were the ones responsible for administering communion. And they were in large numbers, and they represented well. And I know that they made Pastor Madison proud, and I was proud watching them as they served everybody from the table. So we thank our deacons for doing such a marvelous job. St. Mark, I trust we've had a great time today, starting with Sunday school, all the way to our morning worship service. Trust that what has been said today was beneficial to you. And we want to keep in mind all the announcements that have been made, and let's just try to govern ourselves accordingly. Remember, if you haven't already voted, go out and vote. I'm kind of like President Obama. He says, stay focused. Don't ooh, vote. Let's stand. May the Lord bless thee, may the Lord keep thee, may the Lord cause his countenance to shine upon thee and give us peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a blessed week, St. Mark. Thank you.